Hi, my name's Dr. Padilla. I'm a professor in computer science and psychology, and I have been a professor for over 5 years now. Today, I wanted to talk about a question that I get asked a great deal, and that is, how do I get involved in research anyway? If you've been following along with videos on this channel, I talk a lot about the importance of research, particularly in STEM fields, and how this is an important step in a PhD application process. But you might be wondering, how do I even get involved in research? What are the steps? What does research look like in my particular field? So today I wanted to give you my 3-step process for getting involved in research. But to begin, let's talk about what is research exactly? Why is it important? For STEM fields in particular, when you're applying to a PhD program, part of what you're doing is going to be research, okay? But it might not be entirely clear, especially if you're starting out in your educational journey, what research means for your particular field. I think there's some fields where the research is more obvious, but some fields it's not as obvious. For example, computer science, students often don't know what is research in computer science. When you go into computer science as a degree, you're taking classes, you're learning how to program, you're learning about different softwares and different theories. Where's the research in all of that? Well, the people who've developed those different languages, those different theories, they did so with research. And the way that you can tell what the nature of the research is in your particular field is to look at something called Google Scholar, okay? Google Scholar is my best friend. You should definitely get comfortable with it. Now, what Google Scholar is a repository or a search engine for scientific publications. These are publications that have been peer-reviewed that are secured in some way. So when you search Google Scholar, you're not gonna see a blog pop up. You're not going to see kind of a academic book, for example, like a fiction book. You're only going to see peer-reviewed publications that are within the realm of scientific research, okay? So what you could do is take whatever field you're in that you're trying to understand, what is research for this field? For example, it might be AI that you're excited about. And the articles that pop up are the ones that are within the literature of scientific publications. Some things to note about Google Scholar is that in addition to seeing the article, you get indications of where you can find these materials, which is great. Sometimes a PDF will be available to you, other times not, like for this one example. Now, there are tricks and tips for how to actually access these materials. If you're outside of academia and your institution doesn't have access to this, it can actually be a little challenging to get these materials without having to pay for them. But if you Google how to find free research articles, there are resources out there for you. Just do a quick little Google search to try to identify those. If you see something behind a paywall, you can probably get access to it. You just have to do a little bit of digging. But suffice to say that these are the ones that are easier to access. And when you go to these articles, what you want to look for is the methods section. In most all fields, these scholarly papers will have a methods section, and it will detail the research methods that went into that paper. And that will give you a clue about the type of research that's done in your particular field, especially for STEM fields. So that's what research is, and it's important for STEM fields. So let's figure out how to actually get involved in research. Now, my first step in getting involved in research is identifying research opportunities. There's two primary tracks of research opportunities, and one is available to people who are currently at a university, and the other one is available to those individuals and individuals outside of the university. So when I say inside the university, I mean those, if you're an undergraduate student, if you're a master's student, those opportunities are available to you. If you are not currently enrolled, those opportunities unfortunately are not available to you. That is why it's so great to be an enrolled student, because you're paying for your classes, but you're also paying for access to all of these resources. So you definitely want to take advantage of those while you are enrolled. As soon as you graduate, like the day that you graduate, you don't have access to these resources anymore. So just think about that when you're planning out your timeline. But in any case, there's formal research opportunities that may be available to you at your particular department or institution. So what does that look like? It is formal learning opportunities that are research-based. and those will be available on a department website where you apply directly to those opportunities, and you will get placed with a lab or an advisor, and there's structure involved in it, and usually some type of funds associated with it. And so the whole, you know, everyone who applies to this particular portal and has access in that way, okay? Another flavor of this might be there could be a particular class where you learn research methods, and a part of that is actually doing the real research. So that's another opportunity, would be the coursework. And then the final one is potentially a thesis project where you have, again, a course, but the course itself is connecting you with a researcher and you work on your thesis project together and you gain expertise in that way. Those are all really excellent formal opportunities. If those are available to you at your department, absolutely take advantage of them because they are unique and special and not everyone has access to those, and it varies across different departments, okay? So those are the formal opportunities that you only get as a currently enrolled student. There are informal opportunities as well, and these tend to be volunteer opportunities. Now, these are harder to identify because they are individual lab specific. So this is where you would volunteer to a specific lab and work directly with one lab or one advisor, and it requires you having to do more digging. So I wanted to give you some examples of how you might undertake this process of identifying these opportunities. Okay, so let's say that you want to look for research opportunities in HCI, human computer interaction, at MIT, for example. So you could Google MIT, HCI, okay? And usually there's various places that you can access that information. I'm gonna click on this particular link because it matches what you see across different universities slightly more. So you usually see a webpage like this at different departments where it kind of gives you a description of the particular program. And the thing you want to pay attention to is this faculty tab, or sometimes it's called people. So if you click on the faculty tab, what shows up are the different individuals who are within this group who study this particular thing that you searched, which is really great. What I want to call your attention to when you're looking at these individuals is looking at their rank. So there is a range of different professor levels, and this will impact the way that you do research in a lab with them. So at the lowest level is an assistant professor. The next level is an associate professor. Above that is a professor. Nothing before, just a professor. And then above that is emeritus professor. That's someone who's retired, okay? Now, the reason I bring this up is because it could be the case that if you apply to someone at a higher level, like a professor, not an associate or assistant professor, oftentimes they're more famous. They tend to have bigger labs and you might get less one-on-one time with them. So you get a little bit less training with that individual. It's not that it's not a great opportunity, but just recognize that the different people at different levels have different requirements of them. So sometimes it's nice if you're working with someone who's a little bit more junior because they have incentive to publish a lot and do lots of research, and that benefits you as well because there'll be more opportunities for you. So that's just something to look at as you're going through here. Like, this person is a professor, highest level. There's other individuals, like, so she's an assistant professor, lower level, and they work through these levels throughout their career. But okay, so you're looking through these people. What you're wanting to do is take a look at them, look at their lab's website, see if it's interesting. For example, you might be interested in Arvin's work here. You would click on his name, you would find a website. This looks like it's his personal website. The more important thing is you want to find their research page. So you might have to dig for it a little bit. Okay, here's the research page. So here is Arvin's research. Now, what you'll want to do when you go to a lab like this and you see some research that looks exciting, yay, that's great. What you want to look for on their page is, are there opportunities to apply in some way to join their lab? Looking here, I'm not seeing any per se. I see home, publications, videos, and some social media links. But I do notice as I'm looking through here that they do have undergraduate researchers currently in the lab. So here's a few undergraduate researchers. So that means that these individuals somehow got this position. there's no formal process here. And this is the case for a vast majority of groups and labs, is there's no formal application process, but they do accept undergraduate researchers. So this would be a case where you would need to email the PI, the leader of this group, and ask, you know, how do I apply? Do you have any openings for undergraduate research positions? And they would describe to you the process if there are openings at all. So that's a lot of work, right? Find the person, find the lab, email them, see if there's opportunities. But that is how it works, unfortunately. I wanted to show you an example of something that's a little bit more formal, but still involves some background work. Okay, so here is a really excellent research lab, also in data visualization, so very similar group. But notice among the links that they have here is a join option. And when you click that link, it actually has specific information for undergrads who want to apply. There's an apply button and it gives you information about that. If you click that button, it actually gives you clear information about how to apply, and there's a form that you can use to apply. So this is an example of someone who has many more undergraduate researchers in their lab, which is very exciting. And because they have so many more, they have a formal application process, which is really great. I think both types of opportunities are good, but just be aware that some people have a more formal type of form that you need to fill out, and other people don't. You have to kind of cold email them and find those opportunities. So my second step in beginning research is doing the groundwork. Before you actually apply to these different places, there's some things I would encourage you to do that will help increase your likelihood of actually getting one of these positions. As we know, academia is very competitive, and even at this level, it's competitive for these few spots. So there's a few things you can do to increase your chances. Number one among them is to take a course from the professor that you are applying to work with, in part because they often teach courses that are very related to their research. So they will be teaching you things in that course that will directly help you in their particular lab. So you will gain skills that will be useful in their lab. You will gain knowledge that they will find very useful in working with you. So it's a way of kind of getting you up to speed more quickly by taking this formal educational experience that will really lead into the class, okay? So definitely try to take their class. I know some professors who don't even allow research applicants to apply if they haven't taken their class. So that's sometimes the very first step, and it's sometimes fully required, okay? The other part about that is if you take the class, then you will get some more face time with that professor and they will know you. Ideally, you want to perform really well in the class, maybe be the top student in the class, and that will give you a really good inroad for that particular professor because they will know your work, they will know that you're reliable, and trustworthy for conducting research with them. The other types of groundwork that you can do to ensure that you are securing that research position and that you're well prepared is considering looking at cases where that particular advisor in that lab are doing talks. The class has a clear learning objective, and oftentimes those professors want to talk about things outside of the formal structure of the class. They want to talk more about their research, and there's usually not enough time in their class to address all of the elements of their research. So what happens a great deal is professors are asked to give talks all of the time at their universities. So pay attention to their lab website and see if they're giving any research talks, and go to those talks. They will tell you more about their research in those talks and will give you a greater sense of the type of research that they do. The last thing that you'll want to do in terms of creating a foundation in order to actually get those positions as a research assistant is to read the papers coming out of that particular lab. You are going to be doing research that is contributing to those papers, so reading them and having an understanding of what they're doing and how they're doing it will definitely set you apart. So step three is actually applying and securing the role. Now, the way that you want to think about it is there is an application season for research positions, and this starts at the beginning of every semester. So right at the beginning, the first week of the semester, that's when you should be reaching out and submitting your application materials. This, in terms of applications, might be a formal process, as we've discussed, or it might be sending the researcher or the PI your CV and a description of the type of work that you want to do. Usually what happens is after you submit those materials in whichever way they indicate, then they oftentimes interview you for the position. In part, they wanna just see if you would be enjoyable to work with, if you're reliable, and they'll likely have many different applicants. So that's when you need to kind of shine, even though you don't have any experience. What you want to do is communicate that you're reliable and trustworthy, and that you would be a really good fit for that particular role. The way that you would indicate that you'd be a good fit, beyond taking someone's class and going to their talks, is describing some of the papers or elements that you found interesting within that research that you would like to learn. Maybe it's a method that you'd be excited to learn, or you'd have questions about a particular theory. And those things really set you apart. So the third step is simply applying. The major thing to think about for your application is just to make sure that you're presenting yourself professionally, you're providing whatever materials they're asking of you. And because you're just starting out, you're not gonna have a whole background in this, but what they're really looking for is, are you trustworthy? Are you hardworking? Are you intellectually engaged? And that is the main thing to communicate in your materials, but also when you get interviewed as well. So that's my three-step process for getting involved in research. I want to close with a little bit of caveat and discussing the elephant in the room, which is that these opportunities, by and large, are volunteer opportunities. Some of them are paid, but a lot of them are not. And that is because the truth is that they will spend a lot of time training you in these opportunities. And there might be just a small portion of the work that you do ultimately makes it in a paper or is contributing to anything. It's mostly an educational opportunity for you. So for that reason, there is a lot of competition, and it does tend to be volunteer, unfortunately. I know that doesn't work for everyone. It's sort of a privileged position to be able to volunteer time in your week to get this research experience, but that is unfortunately the case of academia. Usually you can expect a commitment of anywhere between 3 to 6 hours per week in a lab, and when you sign up for a semester, you are committing to that for the entire semester. And professors will prioritize individuals that they think might stay with them longer, because for them, training someone takes a lot of time uptake, and then they want to be able to work with that person who has been trained for several semesters, if not several years. And you want to gain those experiences and have it be a deep and rich process. And that kind of only unfolds over time. So unfortunately, it is volunteer by and large, but that is kind of how it goes in academia. Now, last thing I'll say is that if you're coming from outside of academia, all of this can seem really daunting. You're only gonna have access to these more informal opportunities, but there's nothing stopping you from volunteering as well. The only caveat is that there's no inherent incentive for the professor to work with you. We actually get credit for working with students, not credit, but it's part of our job to train students. It's not necessarily part of our job to work with people outside of our institution. We're doing it kind of just volunteering our time. So you would need to be someone really special that they were excited about in order for them to kind of take free time out of their lives to train you and support you. But there's ways to make that happen. For example, I've seen some really successful students or successful people outside of academia get lab positions by bringing in a unique expertise. For example, I had someone interested in working with me, and she worked in this really interesting domain and wanted to apply that to data visualization. That was great because she brought in a new skill and I could train her in what I was interested in. So that was a mutually beneficial experience. So just be aware that it is going to be more challenging for you outside of academia. And it is easier if you're bringing something in, some useful resource, so that if someone is committing some of their limited time to you, that they're, getting something out of it. I hope my three steps for getting into research was helpful. I know it can be very daunting and feel like you have to do a lot of this legwork, and that kind of is the case. But if you begin this process and get some research experience to start, there will be many other research opportunities that unfold once you get your foot in the door the first time. If you like this video, please consider subscribing to this channel. I do lots of videos trying to help you be successful in academia, particularly in STEM. Also, like this video if you thought these tips were helpful. Take care.